Tonight, Julia and I are going to talk to composer Daniel Carter. Okay. Hi, Julia.
Hi, I need to put my headphones in.
Okay.
Because I think, I don't know if you can even see me. Hold on.
I did see.
It looks really bad. Okay.
Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and try to invite Daniel Carter to join us.
Okay. Can you still hear me?
No. Yes, I can.
Okay, just double checking. Okay.
I am now sending the invitation to Daniel Carter.
Okay. Well, I'm sitting here at the computer tonight, so I can email him.
Okay, I think your vertical when you should be horizontal.
Oh, it's doing that thing again. That fix it? Is that better? Or am I still horizontal?
No, I mean, it's all sideways.
See, my phone used to fix it when I did that. If I do this, it's all wonky.
Okay, now it looks good. Now it's good.
It's so weird. It's just, ever since that day I dropped my phone.
All right.
I'll move it
over. We have one viewer. At the moment.
Nice.
And we're waiting for Daniel Carter.
So what have you guys been working on today? Like, have you guys discussed anything as of today?
Well, actually, he had a wonderful new idea about how we could put on the debt collector maybe in Utah, but perhaps we'll wait till he gets here for that.
Oh, of course. Yeah, definitely. I know I want to wait, actually, until he's here to ask a few more questions. But I feel like there's one I could always ask again when he's here. Or should I just wait till later? Because I was just curious, like, how you met him. Can you tell me a little bit without giving too much away? Or
The things that we haven't actually fully decided to do, I don't think that we should discuss it.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that I got. But what I meant was, like, did you know of him on Hub Pages? I guess I could just ask you that. Is that too, like, specific?
Well, I mean, more like the good thing for you to ask us when we're all together.
Okay, I get what you're saying. Okay, I got you.
Okay. Then you could tell his side of the story, and it wouldn't be good for me to tell my side and for him not to hear that.
Okay, I got you. That makes sense.
Now, you might want to check and see if he's having any problems.
Let me check right now. Okay. So, let's do that.
I did invite him.
Bringing up his email now. Let me just send him a message about his email, see if he... That's why it does that. I just left, didn't I?
Okay, I think we might be getting something here.
Good. Now I can't even see me. I get totally left. Go back, Julia.
What happened?
I have to fix something. I feel when I started typing to him, I'm going to be right back. I know it's not what we wanted to do, but I went away like, come on.
Oh.
Yeah, that's one of the problems on my end, like with this phone. Like, it's not you. It's definitely me. But you're still there, so.
Yes, yeah, I'm still here.
Yeah, so it's just me. Like, my camera is gone. Was there? Okay, let's see.
Well, we were a little bit early, I guess, but
I'm still trying to fix it. No, we don't want to do that. Okay, this is not good. Still don't see me at all. Okay. That fixed it, I think. Maybe. Can you see me now? Hopefully. Aya?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay. Yeah.
I could actually text him maybe.
Well, I sent him an email and I asked him, I said, did you?
Okay,
so I sent it to that email that you included about tonight's conversation. I did not receive a response. Maybe he's still trying to connect. So, anyway, I do have something I can talk about just a little bit before he comes on. I was talking with Nell Rose. I don't know if she's a common friend with you on Facebook, but she's from Hub Pages. She lives in England. I think she's pretty cool and pretty fascinating. Maybe she would be someone that in the future, if I talk a little bit more, that we could invite to a live stream. I feel like she's somebody that's kind of open-minded. She knows a lot about genealogy. Oh, I just got a message from Daniel. He said, No, I'm sitting at the computer, but I don't see it. So what I'll do is I'll try and send him.
Okay, I sent you a link on Facebook for the link for the Hangout. Did you see that?
Yeah, I'll send that to him, then I'll do that. Hold on. Copy link. Okay, I'm pasting it to him, so hopefully he'll get it. Okay. Okay, I sent him the link, but I don't really want to do any more typing with the computer. It's kind of wonky.
Right.
Okay, I sent him the link. I hope that's self-explanatory. I think.
Okay, yeah. I texted him that you sent him the link. And he gave it a thumbs up, so we're good, I hope.
Okay, sounds good to me, hopefully. Oh, yeah, but anyway, what I was saying about the genealogy thing before he gets here is that maybe she would be someone in the future that would actually be interested in doing a live stream. She seems very open-minded and interesting to talk to, and we were talking a little bit about genealogy, and she's been doing, like, Jed Match, and she was able to figure out that we're distantly related in England. It was really far back, but we used the calculator, and she's like, oh yeah, we have this really distant match. So I thought that was kind of fascinating. So I invited her to see my tree, and we were talking about some of the names, and we have some similar surnames, which could be common, but you never know. So I thought, she's pretty interesting and fascinating and very open-minded. So I think she'd be somebody that might
It sounds like a good idea.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't asked her yet, but she seems open-minded, and it seems like she would commit to doing that. I don't.
Well, you know what? I'm going to talk a little bit about the debt collector while we wait for him to show up.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, sure.
Okay, so this is the debt collector, which you probably can't see very well. Can you see the music?
I can see it. What I'm going to do, since I'm at the computer, I'm going to try and bring up your YouTube channel, but turn down the sound so the sound's not coming out on it. But so I can see you guys bigger, because you guys can see. Uh-huh. You guys can literally see this because you're doing it on a computer. Okay, this is good, because now I have the computer. Since I'm sitting at the computer tonight, I can mute it and I can see what you guys are doing. Nice.
Oh, okay.
Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Well, it's the music to the opening song of the debt collector. Unfortunately, I can't play it or sing it. But it's kind of dark, and this one is sharing, and it's about a boy and a girl. And the only sharing that's okay is when you want to anyway.
That's true, though, right? I mean,
yeah,
you can't really share. You know, because all these people that claim that they care about sharing with others and that they're social do-gooders, that's not entirely true. They're okay with sharing when it's taxpayer-subsidized, but when it comes to their own money, they want benefits so they can go on trips and they can do things that they want to do. So it's very easy to say that you want to share things when it's taxes that provided those services to do that, because you're not really paying for it personally.
Right. Yeah, I mean, we all enjoy sharing our toys with our friends and our family. And, you know, even as children, we don't have to be told that we have to share. We want to do that with our friends. Mm-hmm. But then where the conflict with adults comes in is when we're told we're supposed to share it with somebody we don't know, and we didn't invite them. That's when we get into problems.
I think so. But even like as a kid, when it comes to the sharing thing, I do kind of have a story about that. Like, I know now they're like, some parents are like, this kid is a horrible child if he doesn't want to share like all his toys on the playground with the other kids. But as a kid, I remember I took good care of my things, and same with my sisters. But when other kids, like when the teacher would force us to share things, like have show and tell and have this gift out that we got for Christmas, like this one boy destroyed like this little keyboard that my sister brought in, and it devastated her. Like, it really upset her. And he, like, for him, it didn't matter because he got so many different things all the time. Like, it was easy for him to destroy that. But that was something special she got for Christmas. So even as a kid, sometimes I didn't like when we were forced to share things, because not everybody would treat it respectfully. And right. It seemed like the people that had more access to things, like they wouldn't appreciate it. So, or it could be the other way around. So I kind of don't like this. I don't like this enforced sharing with kids and making a child feel bad if he doesn't want to share his toys. You know, it gets kind of strange on the playground these days, I think.
Yeah, and even if it's a public toy, you know, a lot of times you're in a public situation, the toy doesn't belong to any of the kids because it's a public toy. But then what you need to teach is taking turns, not sharing. You know, who was here first? How long are you allowed to play with it? When do you have to give it to the next person? And is there a line of people waiting to use it? Then you need to give it to the next person up when your time is finished with this public toy. But even that, a lot of times people are not told. You know, they're just, one child says, I want it, and the other one is told, oh, just share.
Yeah, and sometimes it can be the child that is the loudest or like the most assertive that's going to get more time with a certain It can also be with like a couple computers, like with games for kids, other things where one child, they're a little bit louder, they're more screeching, but they know that they get that. And then there's a parent that tries to teach, you know, equal time, like taking turns. And this other parent's like kind of debunking that. It's just, it gets so strange, like in public spaces sometimes when it comes to any kind of toy. And I know we're supposed to all share, but sometimes I can totally understand if a family just wants to bring their own things to the playground and only their kids can play with it. And I also feel like we don't need to force everybody to be friends all the time. Like, we don't need to force all the kids to try and play together, because that, it doesn't work that way in real life.
No, it's not. It never works that way.
Yeah, so anyway, I was just... some of my thoughts on sharing. Like, I don't feel like it's always plausible. You can share with people you want to share with, but I don't think it's plausible to share with everybody.
Right. Just the same way it's not possible to love everybody. And, you know, then we're told we're supposed to do that.
How is that even possible? And then people get mad at you if you say somebody had a favorite child or a best friend. It's like, is that like really... nowadays, like, do people not have, because that's not true. Like, the people who say like you can't have those things, they have all those things. It's just a form maybe of public shaming when somebody else has those things and they don't want somebody to have those things in a certain situation, like in a classroom, where nowadays if there's a couple of friends, they will literally split these kids up, whereas these kids could work together and maybe study better, more effectively with a friend. But they will literally split these kids up and make them sit away from each other or be in different classes because they think like it's going to inhibit these children from getting along with other children. So, I don't know.
Well, I'm hearing from Daniel Carter, and he said the links you were both sending only take me to Hangout instructions. Now, is that your experience too, that when you get one of those links, it, you get the instructions?
It does, but what I do when I go into the Hangout, you have to like click on the camera and then accept it. Like, I guess okay. I could add myself here 2 times, it'd be kind of funny. Like, I could.
I'm sorry, because I wasn't sure. Yeah.
Okay, I have 2 different accounts up. What I can do is I can see if I can join, like,
Don't join anymore. You know, okay. Let's not jeopardize what we already have here. Okay. I just want to be able to talk him through what he has to do when he gets that link. What does he have to do?
Well, that's how I was going to try and talk him through. Like, there wouldn't be a pic. I'm on the computer. There wouldn't be a. It would just be a picture of me, and I can take it away soon after. But okay, I guess the best way I can explain it is you have to click on the camera icon once you're on Google Hangouts.
Click on a camera. So click on camera icon.
And then it brings you to that screen with all that text, and it asks you to accept. Like, you have to check that box and then click proceed, and it will open up. It should open up the chat after that.
Okay. So after you click on the camera icon, you get what, like, instructions, or you have
to... Yeah, it's like a whole blurb about the Google Hangouts and privacy and how you control the Hangout. And then I just scroll through it. I don't read the whole thing because I'm sure you could if you want to, but I just check the box and I click proceed and it opens me up to the chat. And that works for
what, me. What box do you check? Is it like the box that you say, I agree to have my privacy?
Yeah, you want to click I agree. It's like an I agree box at the very bottom. But I just scroll through the whole thing. I don't read that whole text. If you're sitting there reading the whole text, it's going to take a while because it's many paragraphs. So I would just scroll through it to the bottom and click I agree.
Okay, I guess I should have given those instructions in advance too. So the next time we have a guest, I will also give the instructions about how to sign in.
Okay.
Okay, so I told him, scroll down, I agree box, check it, because I'm typing really, look, I'm not trying to write full sentences here at all. Mm-hmm. Just trying to get the main idea.
Yes. That makes sense.
Yeah, it's amazing that you have to like sign a contract just to get on a live stream.
Ridiculous. I don't know, is it for their liability, I guess? Because I know in some states like California, like recording other people, it's probably a liability thing. I should read all of it, but I don't really feel that I want to read it right now. I'm sure I'll read it later, maybe.
Yeah, maybe. That's what we all say, right?
Like, we well, I have enough things read it later. That I would rather read, I guess. Like, I'm a horrible person because I don't read the Google.
No, it's okay. I don't either. it's just the way it works. So if you remember, I don't know if you saw Mr. Zuckerberg.
Oh, yes.
And he was testifying about Facebook before the Senate. And and he said that they have a lot of instructions and a lot of releases, and you can read the whole thing. But of course, nobody does.
Yeah, exactly. But you know what's funny is they're very upset still, but all this stuff was happening like in 2010 with the elections. I mean, Facebook was doing the same things back during the Obama years. I mean, they've been doing this for a very long time. There have been people using that platform with ads for.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with the ads. I don't have a problem that they have ads.
I don't. It's the privacy issue.
I have a problem with the information. First of all, that as a person who posts there, not all of my information is disseminated to the people that I want to see what I post. Mm-hmm. So I have friends and I have people who have shown an interest in a particular page of mine. And so they've liked that page in order to receive notices. And then they purposely do not send them those notices.
No, they don't. You know, I noticed it this week, which was interesting, because when I went to Ontario to meet my friend, I had somehow logged Ontario as my location on Facebook, which it's not. I live 20 miles away. But now it seems like my Facebook posts are being shown to more people because I have this location on there. Isn't that weird? Like, just listing a location on there is pushing my posts to more people than ever. Like, I'm getting more people liking things this week than I usually do. And I'm just guessing, is it because I posted a location on Facebook?
Well, it has value to them. It has value to the marketers. And I don't want to post a location.
Oh, no, don't do that. This isn't where I live, though, so I don't really care that I posted Ontario because it's just kind of an experiment for myself. I don't live in Ontario. So whatever, they think I live in Ontario, like I live 20 miles away from there. So they can think I live there all they want.
Okay, he says, I've got an update from Daniel Carter. So he says that it's not allowing him to scroll down. So I asked him, are you on a phone? Because that stuff happens. No, he says he's on a computer.
Well, maybe the way I'm explaining it is different because I am on an Android phone and that's how I did it. That's the only reason I was suggesting what I can do. I'm just going to try this. No, it says you're not allowed to join because you don't have a camera on that one. I'm on a phone, so maybe it's slightly different. Maybe he's seen something
Have you ever joined on the tablet? Was it different?
It was the same because the tablet's an Android device. It's a KitKat. Actually, the tablet, this is the funny thing, its operating system is some part of my phone, and it has like half of the memory that my phone has, but it's just in a bigger format. I really need to get a laptop, I'm telling you, because this whole Android thing kind of irritates
me. I'm asking him, is there something he can click on? Because if he can't scroll down, then he needs to click, right?
Yeah, I'm thinking it shouldn't be that different because I clicked. I see a camera icon even when I'm looking here on my computer. It should let him in.
Hi, Dan. Well, I mean, all you have to do is sign their waiver. Basically, they're letting you know you're going to be in public, and they want to make sure we're not trapping you into a public appearance that you don't want to be in. Okay, let me ask you this. Can you take a screenshot of what you're seeing and send it to me, and then I'll try to figure out what it is? Okay. And maybe send one to Julia too in the email, because she's very good with this stuff.
Okay, let me, I'll look as well. Okay, let's see.
Oh, it always happens. There's always something that I forget to tell people. So after several of these, we're going to get this perfect.
Yes, we will get it perfect. Next time, it will be perfect, because I'm stubborn like that, and I just know it'll be perfect.
Okay. So he's sending me a screenshot, or he's sending you one.
Okay, I'm looking right now. You know,
okay.
Another.
So Julia's looking at it.
Okay. I'm on my email, though, and I'm not seeing. I'm going to try saying, let's see. Okay, try this link. Okay. I'm seeing. Let me just say, I'm going to ask him where the screenshot is, if he sent it to me. Dude.
Okay, now, is it to my email, or where did you send it to?
So I don't think him and I are connected on Facebook, so if you try to send it to me there, I don't.
Oh, okay. Another one. Okay. All right. I'll go look.
Okay.
Yeah,
I see something
that I got
now.
An email from you.
I just keep getting things from him. Okay. Now I see it. Okay. Let me look. All right. Get started with Google Hangouts. Okay. Well, it looks like what he needs to do. He needs to click on the computer link. I'm going to tell him that in the email.
Okay. She says you need to click on the computer link. I don't know what that means.
Link. Well, there's something in the screenshot, and at the bottom it says computer, Android, like what you need to use for Hangouts. I'm thinking he hasn't set himself up. I think this is what happened. He hasn't set up his Google Hangouts yet. That's what happened to me, too. That's just my guess. So I would click on the computer link to. Oh, no. We don't want that. Really? No, we do not.
It says click on the computer link that will set up your Hangout. Have you set up the Hangout that you're coming to?
Yeah. To set up. Okay.
Okay. Click on anything, or okay, so you are in your Google account, and you do have a Chrome browser, right? Okay. Well, that seems to be something that you cannot do without. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's it.
Because we had a very famous primatologist here, and she had the same problem. She was using a different browser. That's okay. It pretty much happens to everyone.
They just make it too difficult for the novice, in my opinion. Like, once again, they want to promote this service, and they would could compete better with Snapchat and Facebook Live if they just made it a little bit more seamless. It doesn't, I know it would be just very easy and second nature if you do this all the time for maybe a year, but it should be pretty simple. It shouldn't have to be this many steps to get several people together in a hangout that goes live to YouTube. I'm just, it's, they make it too tricky in my opinion.
Is everything okay there? Okay. I heard an oh no. Oh. Yeah, I try never to change mine unless I absolutely have to. So you're signing into Chrome? Is that what you're doing? Okay, yeah, you do. I thought you were there already. Okay. Well, at least we're teaching our viewers how to do all this.
I'm going to say something to the chat people because I just want to see what they say.
Can you see the chat people,
Oh,
Julia?
yes, I can. They're all talking about how one of them's from England. Diane Leach says, "I'm from England. Nice to hear from you." Alexander Atheist says, "Mate, I'm Scottish. The only thing I hate on England is the royalty and the royal family." And then another one's, and then he says again something about how to watch something about a sailor on YouTube. That I don't
Our viewers
understand.
in England are talking about the royal family while they're waiting for you to come on.
So I'm just going to tell him you should try Ancestry or MyHeritage. I don't know, they might not care, but maybe it'd give him something to think about since they're talking about where they're from.
Okay, Julia is recommending Ancestry and MyHeritage to our viewers.
Only reason being is lately a lot of people are fighting, like splitting hairs over very ridiculous things, like very micro regions they come from. Like, I'm Irish and no, I'm English. It's just, it's really ridiculous because back in time we all come from further afar.
Well, linguistically, Irish is very interesting. But I mean, that's not necessarily genetically.
True. Maybe you can tell us more about that another time. I would be
Yeah,
interested.
yeah. We should have a linguist on to talk about that kind of thing.
Okay. Sounds good. So I feel like asking the people in the chat, they didn't respond to that. Let me see what else I can say to them. What is your favorite play?
Okay, good question. And do you like musicals? You should ask them that.
I'll ask them that. And do you
They're
like,
asking our viewers if they like musicals.
no response. They all stopped talking to me.
Oh no. We made them self-conscious. Uh-oh. They thought we couldn't see them.
Well, maybe more people will come. When we're sitting here, I need to share the link some more places. I shared it on my main Facebook page. Now I'm going to go share it on the Julia Hanna blog page, because why not?
Okay, and if you can share it, tag me on Facebook.
I thought I did, but I'm gonna go back and edit that.
Okay. Oh, I made it.
I'm gonna hang up now because I see you.
I made it finally. Can you hear and see me now?
Very good.
Oh, I can't hear you. So okay, there we go.
Hello.
Oh, now we can't see you.
We'd
like to see you.
Are you there?
Yes. Can you see me? And Julia? Can you see Julia?
I still can't hear you.
I can see you.
Oh, gosh.
And hear you.
What am I doing? Camera, microphone.
You need your speaker on rather than mic. If we hear you. We can hear you.
Still not there.
Okay. Julia, if you put him on the phone, could you talk him through this problem?
Do you want me to call him on the telephone?
No, it's okay. I can call him on the phone.
I'm clicking these icons and they're not doing anything.
Okay. All right. So in my experience, what you want to do is you want to make sure you don't have the an X, a slash through the microphone. Because I can't hear you, so that seems to be okay. And I see you again. Do you hear me? And Aya now?
Hi there.
I do. Yes.
Okay. I don't know why. I can't hear you. I can see you, but I can't hear you.
Okay. Julia, can you hear me?
It's really echoing now, so you want me to try and walk him through it, is what you're saying? Okay, so what I would do is I would make sure that you're inside. Are you in the Google Hangout chat? Is that you're in there, right? I see you. So make sure your microphone, I guess, I really can't hear anything now. It's all echoey. Okay.
I can through the phone, but I can't on the computer.
You can't hear me on the computer? Oh, great. Okay, let me see what I can.
Getting massive amounts of feedback.
I'm hearing a lot of noise. So,
yes, and I'm not quite sure why it's not working. Oh boy.
Okay.
Well, shoot.
Dan, if you can come back on visual, I can ask you questions. Yeah, through the telephone.
Oh, his microphone
and
is muted.
You can answer them, and we hear you. So we can do that.
Yeah.
So the first question
I want to ask you
is
about your childhood experience
with music. Were you always into music? Oh, yeah, go ahead and talk into the computer.
His microphone is muted.
Oh, wait. Yeah, why is your microphone muted?
Your microphone was muted.
It was, and I accidentally did that.
Oh. But
I can only hear you through the phone, though, and I'm not quite sure what that's about.
Okay.
Did you hear my question?
Yes. Was I always interested in music? When I was very young, like around 5 years old, I had a really, really unusual experience that happened to me. I was at my grandmother's house, and I was listening to, of all things, I think I'm getting feedback because of that. I was at my grandmother's house and listening to a choir. It was the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. And it was quite an experience for me simply because I was just sort of overpowered with this idea, this feeling that my whole life was going to be music. And I had this sort of experience that where I was told that I would sort of do certain things with my life. And it's very odd to me that many of those things have happened. And in fact, it could be that all of them happened. And it was, I think it was an experience I needed because the rest of my childhood was pretty rough. I grew up there was a lot of abuse at home growing up. And my father, as I reflect back on it, he had a lot of trauma in his childhood. He didn't know how to resolve that. And so he did the best that he could. And I was the oldest child. And he basically needed me to become like him. He wasn't interested in music and he didn't really understand the arts. And he had this boy who was all things arts and music and all the beautiful things in life, and he did not know what to do with it. And it drove a terrible wedge between us, and there was a lot of physical and emotional abuse. And it took me decades to figure out how to resolve and work through the trauma of all of that. But the older that I got through that, the more I realized that my dad, in a very real way, in that period of American history in the 60s, he pretty much did the best that he could. We didn't have the same type of psychological health services that we do now. It was sort of a taboo back then. And and so before he died, we were able to resolve a lot of those issues between us. And that was really a good thing. Actually, Dad had a beautiful singing voice. He had a beautiful baritone voice and was, he did sing when I was quite young. And it was kind of one of the joys of my life at that point. But it's one of the good memories that I have of Dad as a young man. But through that time, I took up flute. I went to this thing. They were having several schools. I came from a very rural area, Caldwell, Idaho. Very small. There was about 10,000 people there. And I went to this sort of seminar. It was a recruiting seminar to get kids into band. And I wanted to play flute. So I played flute for about 3 months, which turned out to be an absolute disaster. And I didn't want to learn how to read music. All I wanted to do was play the songs. And so we were playing these little folk songs, and I would play them by ear. I'd figure it out on, you know, with my flute, with a fingering and stuff, and play the notes, but I never learned how to read music. And my grandmother would sit with me and try to coach me through that. And after about 3 months, I was done. And Dad was very happy with that. And after that, when I was about 11 or, well, it was, I think it was about, yeah, I was about 11. We wound up moving to Northern Idaho, and we had a piano in the house that we rented. And eventually we bought that piano, and that became the piano that I grew up with. It wasn't a great one. It was never in tune. And I immediately started picking out melodies and creating my own songs at the age of around 10 or 11 at that point. One of the earliest people, the pieces that I remember from that period, I can still play, and I'll just play a little snatch. I'm sitting at the piano because I thought I might do this. And it sounded like this. And it went on.
Very nice.
And I learned how to play it high and low. Really fast and really slow, really low, and it goes on from there. And so I would drive people nuts playing this stupid little piece over and over and over again, driving them crazy with it. And then I just began continuing to compose more and more and more pieces. And so a lot of those pieces from earlier childhood, they got lost on the wayside. That's one of the few remaining. It's actually one of the ones that made the most musical sense, and that's why I think I remembered it. But by the time I was about 16, I was writing other pieces. And at our church, I grew up LDS, Mormon. And at our church, there were a couple of people who advocated for that. And they made sure that my music got heard in certain places. So, but anyway, so I pursued that for a while. And then at the age of 16, I became a choir director at church, which was rather unusual. And at first it was a youth choir, and then I sort of took over assistant directing for the director on occasions for church. And then from there, as I got into college, Rick's College, the other sideline of this is that I also was very active in art classes all through high school. And I won a few awards with that kind of stuff.
Drawing?
Pardon?
Was it drawing or painting?
Yes. Yes, it was mostly drawing, a little bit of painting, and I'm really not a great artist. I am not. I have a knack for looking at good art and evaluating it and working with artists and coaching them about what I think something would work well for a particular project or something like that. But as an artist myself, it's not that great. I did a sunburst. It was a silkscreen sunburst, and it became the logo for my little production company, Under the Sun Productions. I did that when I was 15, and it turned out it actually was a terrible, terrible mistake. The silkscreen was falling apart and everything else, and so was my image. But the ink was beginning to dry on the silkscreen, and my teacher came along and says, "Oh my gosh, this is brilliant. You have to do this on newsprint. You have to do it on cardboard. You have to do it on these different things." So I made 3 or 4 prints before the ink dried up and kept 2 of them, sold one to her, I think for $10. I was so thrilled. And she entered it in an art contest, and it placed, but I don't remember what placement it made, but they did a little to do with us in the newspaper at that point. And so as a result of that, when I got to college, I actually went to college on a very small art scholarship, not a music scholarship. They did not want me in the music department because I really didn't have any music skills. I didn't start piano until I was about, I think I was about a junior in high school. I diddled around on the piano.
Well, let me ask this. Were you fluent in writing at that time?
No, not at all. I finally got with a piano teacher that she was really quite brilliant, but she was also incredibly patient, and I needed that. She kept saying, "Dan, you have got to learn to read music. If you're going to be a composer, you have to notate it so that people like me don't have to sit up all night with you and try to figure out what you're playing on the piano and write it down for you." And so that was my first real push toward becoming musically skilled. And by the time I got to college, 2 years later, they were like, "Yeah, this music thing is not going to work for you." And but by that time, I had composed some things that it made their sort of eyebrows raise. I was composing things like imitating Bach's 2-part inventions. I thought, well, that's brilliant. I wonder if I could do that. And so I wrote a couple of 2-part inventions, and I wrote some other imitation of other composers and so on. And it was based on that that they said, "Well, there's something here, but you've got so much makeup time. You've got really a decade or more of makeup time to do." And so I was with a piano teacher. Her name was Carol Barris. She passed away 3 or 4 years ago, and we've been in touch off and on throughout all these decades. But she was actually wonderful for me to work with. And she, I'm getting lots of feedback on this. That's better. And so she encouraged me as well. I remember learning Sonata Allegro form in a master theory class, And it was a Friday afternoon, and I went back to the dorm, and I stayed in the practice rooms most of the weekend, and I wrote a sonata. It was just a one-movement sonata. It was based, well, I thought, I'm not sure how to construct it on original melodies, but if I were to take Mary Had a Little Lamb and do it in the style of Mozart, I bet I could write a sonata. So I did. And Monday morning, 8 a.m., I was at piano lessons, and she said, so how did your weekend go? And I said, it was fine. I said, I wrote a sonata. And she goes, what? You did what? And so I was so... I can play a little bit of it, yeah. It's crazy. Anyway, and then it goes on, there's a second theme. I don't remember it. It's been over 40 years. I'd have to look at the music, and I don't want to take time to do that. But I actually did post this sonata online at YouTube. And so you can actually hear it.
Okay, well, we'll put a link to this later when I edit the video.
We're getting so much feedback, I don't know what you said.
I said I will post the link later.
Oh, okay. Great. That sounds good. Yes. Yeah, it was a fun piece. And so I kind of got through college looking at learning a lot about the composer's theory, everything else, and imitating a lot of composers, writing some songs, writing some choral music. And as it developed, choral music became my mainstay. And so I've been known all these years as a choral composer, mostly of religious music. And I spent a lot of time, excuse me, writing choral music for the LDS Church. And a lot of it was used and published. And as a result, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir in 2011 recorded a piece of mine called Come Unto Him. And that's also on YouTube. And that was on a CD called This Is the Christ. And that CD went to number one status the first week of its release in 2011. So that was pretty exciting. That was great.
Can I ask something about your process of composing? Because before I worked with you, I always assumed that melody came first. But I kind of have the feeling
that's not the case in your case. When you start to compose.
Well, it's actually, it can come music first. When I was much younger, music usually did come first. But as I have worked with lyrics and even written some of my own lyrics, it can come somewhat simultaneously, but it usually comes, if someone hands me a lyric, I have to study the lyric and I have to feel where it is in the placement of the melody that emotion is going to be suited best. In a vocal range, for example, a baritone, the tessitura of a baritone voice is going to have a certain feel to it, just as a soprano, alto, or tenor. And so you want to make sure that melody sits right in their tessitura so that they can do this really, they can portray the emotion of what the words are. And so I've actually composed in every direction you can compose. Words first, music first, kind of together-ish. I even taught music in 1989 for about seven or eight months at a public school. I was a general music teacher. I didn't want to stay in that profession. I didn't enjoy that. There's too many politics in schools, but I had the kids, to give them an idea of musical concept, I had them take recipe cards. They went home and they found a recipe that they wanted to set to music. And so that music could be either just rhythm only, or it could be just a melody line, or it could be both. But that's how I kind of introduced them to this principle of composition. And so And then, you know, and through the years, I became the music publisher for the LDS Church from 1989 to 2016. So 27 years as a music publisher. And that was quite a remarkable experience in a lot of ways. I worked with translators all over the world that hum is a little overpowering sometimes, but I worked with translators all over the world and we set music in about 145 languages. And I estimated that in my career, I probably published between 100,000 and 150,000 pages of music for the church. And this was in addition to, and then I would come home at night and work on my own compositions and publish them on the side on weekends and evenings, that type of thing. So it's been a passion. I learned how to write good choral music and I became a pretty good editor, knowing how to present music and words on a page and make it readable. So that was great.
Julia, do you have a question? And I will repeat it so that you can ask again.
Yeah, I do. Actually.
Can you repeat that?
I do have a question.
Can you repeat that again?
I will repeat what Julia says after she says it.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. So, I guess what I'm going to ask Daniel Carter is, because he mentioned that he taught in the public school, and I'm familiar with that too, because I taught there for a couple of years. Going into it too deeply, but was it during his time period, had they already started implementing a lot of standards? Did it take away creativity and being able to teach music? Was he held to like a rigid, was the politics of teaching that he was held to a rigid standard about what he was allowed to teach, I guess, is my question.
Okay, so Julia says that she also taught in the public schools. And she's interested in her teaching experience.
And she wants to know if at that period
they had already
implemented a lot of standardized kind of teaching and teaching to a particular test. And was that part of the problem? And what were the politics like?
Well, I got into secondary education as a little bit of a loss as to what to do as a composer. I did not want to go on and get a doctorate degree in music because it didn't seem like that I was very well suited for the university environment. And academically, I felt strong as a composer because I knew how to get into composer scores and study, you know, to figure out how they constructed them and the reasons why, and their thinking about what they were doing when they constructed it. So I got into secondary education because I also loved working with kids. The problem with teaching at that point in time, in 1989, we used a manual called the Silver Burdett music approach in secondary education, and it's really quite a good one, and I don't know where the standard has gone since then. I haven't kept up. At that point in time, the school district that I was working for was involved in massive amounts of illegal dealings. There was there was some conspiracy going on, and there was some money laundering and all kinds of really pathetic things. In addition, not keep a music teacher there. I was the third music teacher to arrive on the scene in 3 years. And they could not wait to get out of there, and neither could I. In fact, I terminated I resigned before the school year was over. And the reason I did is not only because of the absolutely poor quality of administration, but also because of the absolute terror that the parents were creating in that environment. They would terrorize the school teachers, they would terrorize the administration. And so it was a terrible situation, and I basically just walked away. during that period, I lucked out in being able to get the job for the LDS Church as the music publisher. They never really listed me as the music publisher. They listed me as a music technician of sorts. But by the time I left 27 years later, they honestly did not treat me very well. They kind of pigeonholed me into the same position without any options for promotion and advancement. And I was never paid that well, but I really put a lot of my heart into it, and I did a lot of good work. And so as a result of that and many, many other factors, when I retired, I've sort of stepped away from just about all religious affiliation. And I feel fine about that, but I don't have any regrets about what I've done, nor do I want to grind any axes over, you know, having worked for the church, and because our family and friends are still devout members, many of them, and so on. And so I think it's just a good way for me to step away and take a new perspective on a lot of things. And I'm quite happy about that, actually. It's a good place to be. So, and now then, since then, I haven't looked back at education so much, but I was on the church's general music committee for about 20 years, and I made some global policy decisions with some of the other decision makers. And I did some keynote speaking, and I did some seminars, and I would talk to all age groups. The people that I loved to work with most were the young kids. And so I would go in as a chorister or as a pianist, and I would just have a blast with them and teach them all kinds of songs. And the 11-year-old boys who absolutely refused to sing, I'd pick two of them by the scruff of the neck, they were causing trouble, and bring them and sit them up by the piano bench with me. And shake my, I have a missing finger. I have 2/3 of my right index finger, and point my finger at their face and say, if you don't shape up, you're going to have a finger like this.
My. And that's quite a motivator.
And so then, and then also I'd say, and then again, if you don't shape up, I'm going to make you learn how to direct music. And so I teach them how to direct music, and we had a blast. It was a good thing. And so I had lots of good experiences, not directly in public education, but in other ways. And then through the years, I've taught piano lessons and composition lessons and orchestration lessons, all kinds of lessons to adults and teenagers and some children. And it's been a really, really good history with me. And I still enjoy doing it. And now I have a hearing loss. It's stabilized at 45%, and the tinnitus, the ringing, makes it difficult. So I don't teach. And I've decided that because the tinnitus is making it much more difficult for me to work on some projects, that I'm taking this year off. And I may do a few musical things, but I haven't found anything that just says, yeah, let's do it. So, and I think that that's critical, because this discomfort with this hearing loss, there'll be a turning point with it. I don't think this is the end. I just think that I need to figure out how best to work with it at this point in my life. So that's kind of where things.
But you just came out of a really big project, Other Wise Men.
Oh yeah.
Can you tell us about that?
Yes. Well, back in 1993, I was at a family reunion. My mother's family are all from Oklahoma. And they're Southerners, and my mother actually was a Southern Baptist, and she found a Mormon boy and married him and then joined the Mormon church after. So that's another story in and of itself. But we went back to a family reunion in a little tiny, tiny place called Hydro, Oklahoma. And I remember flying in. It was about 106 degrees when we flew in at about 100% humidity. So we'd virtually run from place to place, anything that was air conditioned, to save our lives. And one afternoon, we took a trip over to from Hydro to Weatherford, Oklahoma. And there they had an antique mall. And in this mall, I found this little book by Henry Van Dyke, The Other Wise Man. And I thought, well, this is curious, you know. And I picked it up and bought it and started making notes in the margins and saying, this could be a song, or, you know, this could be a chorus, or whatever it was. And so in 1994, we constructed I constructed, with the help of a few other songwriters, a concert version of this Other Wise Man story, and we performed it, and we performed it again in 96 and 98. By 98, we had dumped the original score, recreated, and I had composed an original score of 25 pieces and orchestrated it. We performed it with, let me see, there was we had a native voice choir and about a 40-piece orchestra and some soloists, and we had a narrator telling the story. And I thought, well, we should develop this. And then after that, I thought, well, maybe it could be a stage musical. And then my life kind of went to hell after that. My first marriage dissolved in 2001. It took a long time to get through all of that. And I wound up being homeless in that process. And so then I was taken in by my dear friends, David and Ann Loudon. And so they saved me from being on the streets, at least. And here I held a full-time job and everything at that point. But it was just a really, really difficult time. It was horrifically expensive, and the divorce did not go well for me at all. It worked mostly in her favor. But the good news is, through all of that, that my ex-wife and I are on pretty good terms now. And so that worked out in the end. And living with David and Ann Loudon, I would play these things from Other Wise Men. Oh, I have this idea, and I think that this is where it could go in the story. And I was rewriting the score. I dumped the whole score from 1998 again and started reconstructing it in 2004 after my first divorce was complete. So from 2004 till 2017, this project has been in development, and we finally did a very abbreviated concert version in 2015. And we raised, on that night, we did it at St. Mark's Episcopal Cathedral in Salt Lake City, and we raised about $4,000 for the food pantry, for Hildegard's food pantry. And I thought, you know, this is what I want to do. This project should be for paying it forward, because I understand the plight of, at least in part, I understand the plight of homelessness. And so formed a team. It took a long time through all the poverty and a failed second marriage of 1 year. And that's a story that I won't even get into, but I survived it. And during that marriage, there was a suicide attempt, and I had to really figure out what I wanted from life. And so I came a long way from those dark years to being able to produce Wise Men. And I surrounded myself ultimately with a great team, and there were some real, real champions for this. My friend David, who I lived with, his wife passed away while I was living there. And a few years later, finally, Gail Franson comes into my life. He championed this so wonderfully, along with his daughter, Mindy, who became our music director and was also in the show last year. And after the show closed last year, actually the second night of the show, David passed away. So he was never able to see the show. And I found out about 15 minutes before showtime that he had passed. And I was pretty devastated. But I put everything on hold. I just said, okay, I can't go here emotionally. So it's time to focus on the show. And then when we closed the show, then I did a little private concert and then prepared for David's funeral. And it was actually a wonderful experience. You know, it was so stressful at the time, but it was a wonderful experience. And then the beginning of this year, my hearing started, the tinnitus, the ringing started really becoming awful. So with that, I had another audiology test. He said, you're stable. You've been stable 3 years, but your stress is what's making the tinnitus so bad. So I decided to pull back and take a break. And that's kind of where things are now. But then you and I collaborated on a show.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, that was 2009, way back when we both started on HubPages. Did you start in 2009 then?
Yeah, I think I might have started in 2008, but about the same time.
Yeah.
2008.
Yeah, that's what I thought. You were a little bit before me, as I recall. And yeah. And then, as I recall, you put out the query about, I'm thinking about the stage musical and I'm looking for a composer, and I answered the call and submitted some pieces.
I thought it was the other way around.
Oh, was it? Well, whichever way it was, I don't care. It seemed to be a great collaboration from the get-go.
Yeah, I was really afraid that you wouldn't like it because it's very, you know, libertarian.
Well, that's the thing I loved about it, is that I've truly not made a very good Mormon ever in my life. I've taken exceptions to all kinds of doctrines and dogmas and everything else, and I've not made a huge fuss about it. But in my heart of hearts, I went, yeah, I don't think, I just, no, that's not setting well with me. And so, but the thing I loved about your writing was it was honest. It was a little bit edgy and honest. And it was also quite comical. You know, some of the lyrics about we are seven, the seven siblings. And so the debt collector started breathing life in both of us. And we wrote, let me see, there must be at least 20 songs in that, I think.
Yeah, I had it here. I was showing it to people.
Oh, there it is.
Yeah. So the last one that I have here is number 33.
Yes, there you go. Yep, and of course, I think that what I figured is that we wrote 20 original songs, and with the reprises, it comes out to be 33 or 34.
Yeah.
And, yeah. You know, I haven't even actually counted the number of pieces in Wise Men, but there are 47 pieces total right now. And we're thinking about altering some things. But the one thing I remember most when I started reading The Debt Collector is how alive these characters are, that they have their own honest plight about where they are in life. And this cataclysm of them all sort of crashing together, and the strife and the unfairness, the injustice, and then finally figuring out that there can be forgiveness and there can be a change in behavior and a change in attitude, more inclusive attitude.
Right.
And I think that's the thing, one of the things that I've loved most about the show is that idea of inclusiveness, and that we can come together from seemingly disparate backgrounds.
So. Yes, that's the whole point of the thing. If only we could do that with other people.
Exactly, yep. And I think we have something, I really do. One of the things that I want to do, and I emailed you about this, Salt Lake Acting Company's possibility. Yeah. They're quite edgy and they're quite progressive in what they choose to do.
But do I have to move to Utah in order to be a Utah playwright?
Well, I know that they do more than Utah playwrights.
Oh, okay, good.
So that's the plus. And I know that they've worked with playwrights all over the country. But they're principally known for trying to develop Utah talent. But I think that if I were to try to develop more connections with them, then that would obviously make our team, an advantage in this case. So,
right.
That might be something.
Julia, did you have a question?
Let me think. Okay. So I guess another question I have, like, not to deviate from what you guys are talking about pages, I was curious, is Daniel Carter still active there, or has he stepped back from that side as many of us did, or does he still publish anything there, or if not, does he do more of his own website?
About your activity on web pages. Are you still there?
I am. I haven't written hardly anything for quite a long time, but I've left everything that I've written at Hub Pages, and I've not tried to pull anything. I know a lot of people did, but my thought is to just leave it, because I don't know, it's not my first focus. But the other thing that I found is that my writings the people who follow me want to know about my music mostly. And so what I turned to doing is writing the stories of how a lot of these compositions came together. For example, the piece that the Mormon Tabernacle Choir recorded and that it went number one on Billboard's charts, I wrote the story of how that came together. There's another famous song in the LDS circles, music circles, called Shine For Me Again, Star of Bethlehem. And that's extremely popular among the Mormon music people. And it's hardly known outside of that the Mormon population, but it's leaking out there a little bit at a time. And so that story becomes more and more important. And then I have a hymn in the Mormon hymn book. And I wrote that when I was 28, and that was quite a story because that hymn was actually rejected 7 times before it was actually included. And now that it's been included and published since 1985, it's sold I don't know how many 100 million copies. And that was a gift to the church. So I've never made any money on any of the things that I gave to the church were just gifts. And so that's another reason why I have pursued publishing independently. And to try to make a little money at my craft once in a while.
You had a book about your piano. You had a very touching story about a piano that you
Yes. had. Yes. The piano, I mentioned the piano that we grew up with. And we rented a house. We had moved from Caldwell, Idaho to Lewiston, Idaho, up near the Panhandle, near Moscow, Idaho, where the university is. And there were a set of circumstances that led us there. We rented a house, and in that house was this piano. And over time, Dad bought the piano. He wasn't a fan of me playing the piano, but he knew it was my love, and he gave me a piano. And I thought that was, looking back at that, that was pretty sweet. Yeah. And we never had any money to tune it. It didn't get tuned until I inherited it and I had children. And by then it was pretty beat up. One of the legs, it was an upright piano, and it had 2 legs on the front of it. And one of the legs would come off easily. And so my 3-year-old son would take the leg off the piano, hold it like a baseball bat, and threaten his sister with it. And I, in those days, I stripped and refinished the piano and had it tuned once or twice. And eventually, it went to my daughter, Elizabeth, who's now 34. And she has it. And so when I go over to her house,
waltz for her, right?
That's right, I did. In fact, let me play a snatch.
Okay.
And it goes on from there. But so I wrote that when she was 5 years old, and she and my son Michael, who was 3 at the time, danced around the room a couple of times, and they tumbled and everything else. And that memory kind of sustained me through a lot of dark years. And so that's a very sweet memory. But the piano, when I was divorced, I didn't have anywhere to keep the piano, so my ex-wife kept it. When I finally got it, I had it for about 3 years, but I moved 19 times in 16 years, and it was just way too much for me to try to stuff into these little tiny holes that I was living in. So I gave it to my daughter, and she now has it. And now I have this beautiful kawai, and I never expected I would get it, but that's thanks to all the love and gifts of the people that I'm surrounded with. So That's been a wonderful thing. So now the story about the piano is that after I inherited the piano, I was trying to pay tuition for college. And I pretty much paid my own way through college. My parents did help 1 or 2 semesters. And it came down to me having to sell the piano to pay tuition. So I very reluctantly sold the piano. And then the deal was that I could buy it back at any point in time for the person I sold it to for the same price that they paid for it. Well, that opportunity kept escaping further and further away. And my brother, Tim, and I, who's just younger than me, became roommates. And he knew how I felt about that. And I was flunking out of school, but it wasn't going well at all. I was under a lot of stress, trying to make ends meet, working a lot of hours at a grocery store for about less than $3 an hour, as I recall. And, you know, not having enough time to study, and I wasn't a good pianist, and BYU faculty didn't like that. And so I was kind of frustrated about the whole situation. And my brother Tim wound up getting a pretty good job. So he, for Christmas that year, surprised me and bought the piano back, and he came whooshing in with cold air surrounding him and said, "We have a piano to move." And I went, "What?" He goes, "Hurry up, get your coat. We have a piano to move." And I said, "Tim, I have to study for final. This is critical. I'm flunking out of school." He says, "It won't take very long. Help me move the piano." So I reluctantly got my coat, clambered into the pickup, drove up to the place of the person who bought my piano. I said, "Oh, great, great. She sold the piano to somebody else, and now that opportunity is going to go away forever." So when the door opened, there they both stood with smiles on their face. And there was me, you know, like, "Oh, no." And he said, "I thought you wouldn't mind helping me move your piano back home." And so I ran in and played Hallelujah Chorus and a bunch of Christmas carols, and we hauled the piano on the pickup and moved it over. So, yep, that's my little story.
But do you have the book? Can you show us the book that you made about that?
I can. And I got to run upstairs for 1 minute to get it. I'll be right back.
Okay.
I'm excited. This is interesting.
Yeah. And I love that he can play for us.
I know. It's so, like, calming. Like, I just wish he could play for us all night.
Yeah.
So I did ask the viewers a few questions, but they all left after I asked them. And I also told them how they could find Mary Had a Little Lamb.
So
there's
this is the little book.
Okay.
And it is available at my website, danielcartermusic.com. It's called Another Christmas Carol, because in the story, I ran in and I played a Christmas carol, then I played another Christmas carol, and then another Christmas carol. And this is the program from Art of the Other Wise Man from last year.
Oh, it's beautiful.
And
I love that painting.
Yeah. My friend Dan Fried, we commissioned him to do 6 paintings, and they're all in storage right now because it's not Christmas.
Okay.
So we need to figure out how to give these paintings a more permanent place besides just in our homes. So we're sorting through those details as well. And there's a gift book associated with the Other Wise Man. Let me see if I can find it. You can see the logo painting, and then on the inside you can see there's all kinds of great art. It tells the story. We haven't finished the gift book because we haven't locked in exactly how we're going to tell the story. We'd like both to match, but there's some really great artwork in here, all done by Daniel Fried. And we don't know exactly when this is going to be done, but I don't want to print it and have a whole bunch of inventory sitting around for 10 years like I did with all the music books. I used to have 13 books of music, about 450 pieces, and I had a good distributor. I published them, and she distributed them, and she slowly went out of business because the market changed significantly, and I wound up storing nearly 4,000 books of music. And after finding out how many people photocopy music from those books rather than just buy the books, I decided to get rid of them. So in March last month, I had them shredded. I took over 3,000 books to the shredder because the inventory was getting old. Some of them were getting damaged. And I think what the next step would be is to take some of those pieces and release them as single pieces. And my music still could be found at holysheepmusic.com and also at jackmanmusic.com. And I have published with a couple of other publishers, but I think I'll probably stick with that, the ones that I've been working with.
Well, I was wondering if print on demand would not be the problem of having to store them.
Yeah, it does take care of the inventory problem. It doesn't really take care of the photocopying problem and the illegal piracy. Holysheepmusic.com, let me see if I can, I've got, they have a label. Holysheepmusic.com has a label. So there's a place on the front page of the music. You actually go in and you make your order. You can look at the music and you can listen to the music at holysheepmusic.com. And then you order it and it's immediately downloadable. You can print out the number of copies that you purchased. But the best part of this is that you also receive a label that you put on a physical label, and it's on the music itself, and it's multicolored, so that regular photocopying won't really work very well. And because it's actually a label that you place on, there's this raised effect. And so anything that's just gray, a gray label, is an illegal copy. And so that was a clever device that David Zabriskie came up with in order to help solve that problem. And that seems to be working fairly well for the most part. In fact, I found out from David that the first quarter of this year that I was the best-selling composer for one of my pieces, which really surprised me. That was nice. But I've sort of backed off from publishing sheet music, although I do have a Christmas song that I'm going to publish this year. Cool. So hopefully, I don't know if that'll take traction, but hopefully it will. We'll see.
Well, I'm hoping that someday we can publish a version of the debt collector that have the music and the play and everything.
Yes, I would love that also. And that's actually, in my view, that's a simple thing to do. Publishing is easy. Marketing and distribution is that's a can of worms.
That's true.
But as we both know, it takes an awful lot of marketing and PR to get the message out and to sell the product. It's the same way with Wise Man. With Wise Man, what we do, I've set up a nonprofit production company that we've talked about, Under the Sun Productions. And so we've solicited sponsorship and funding from corporations and different entities in order to fund the performances. And then from ticket sales, we take a portion of those proceeds and donate to charity. And the charity that we've chosen is Family Promise, at least for now. There are just so many other possibilities that we could support if we can grow this and keep it going. So, but yeah, it's been a wild ride and a good time, up and down.
Yeah. So do you want to play us another song?
Sure. I'll play Somewhere Over the Rainbow for you. This is a little bit of an interesting story, because while I was at BYU, I told this story in the little Christmas book. The chairman of the piano department at that point did not like me, period. I had this missing finger, and I was a house painter on the side in those days, because that's the skill that my father gave me. And he said, "You don't even have 10 of these." He said, "I don't know why you think you can be a pianist." He said, "Do you play another instrument?" "No," et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, the long story short is that I was such a bad pianist, classical pianist, that they pretty much kicked me out of that program. And so I went to a jazz piano teacher named Jerry Harris. And Jerry Harris would sit me down with what's called a fake book. And I'd sit at the piano with the music, and it would be a melody line with chord symbols above it. And it's, and they were jazz chords, very complex chords. And so he would say, now I want you to ignore all the chord symbols and improvise your own arrangement for this. And then he assigned me to do Somewhere Over the Rainbow for piano juries. And I was scared to death because I'd never passed a jury in college. You have to have at least a B minus to pass juries. And if you have a C, then they'll boot you out of the program. Well, I couldn't get past a C. I was not a good pianist. But I came up with this arrangement of Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and it did impress them. I got a B minus because I was nervous and didn't play it that great. But so that I kept a hold of it all these years. I threatened to write it down, but I haven't done that yet. So I'll play Over the Rainbow.
Okay. I think you once sent me a recording of that for my daughter.
Oh, seen
that.
I remember that now. I do. I think I had it up on SoundCloud for a little while, and then I took it down. And it's mostly because I don't have permission yet to distribute that version anyway. But
yeah.
Yeah. It's one of my favorite pieces. When I do little private concerts and things, I usually end with that one.
It's so cute. So I think we've come almost to the end.
What are your plans for the future, for the next year, when you're not going to be doing music?
I've thought about doing some writing, writing stories from growing up, childhood, that type of thing. The thing that I've learned is that I think life is a beautiful experience. And it took me over 50 years to come to that conclusion. But I don't want to focus. I think the thing that I want to say to people is that in tragedy and in trauma and all the things that affect us negatively, there can be a hidden benefit. There can be a hidden blessing or of some type in these things, you know, but there's no obligation for us to come to that conclusion. It's just simply up to us. But if we do, we win. We're the ones that we get to make our lives more beautiful as a result of it. And so I've been thinking about maybe what to write. and I'm not sure how to present it yet, but because sometimes it sounds pretty awful. But, you know, I suppose it's like telling Grimm's fairy tales. Sometimes they're really terrible, but they have good endings, you know. So I don't know. I'll figure something out. So that's kind of what I'm pointed at now, anyway.
Julia, did you want to ask anything more before we?
I guess another question I just want to ask was I found some of your videos on YouTube. So do you have a channel that you update regularly that people listening could follow?
Okay, she's asking about your YouTube channel. So when people watch on YouTube, is there a channel where they can go to see your composition or hear your composition?
Yes. My name is Daniel Carter, or if there may be more than one, I haven't checked more recently, but it's also Daniel Tunes 55. 55 is the year I was born.
Okay.
In the last century.
We're all born in the last century.
Yeah, yeah.
So I am on YouTube, and let me see, still on Hub Pages under my name, Daniel Carter. And let me see, for music, it's holysheetmusic.com and Jackman Music. I do have a couple of pieces, three pieces with Neil Achos, which is KJOS. But they always distribute through the retailers. But those pieces are also on my YouTube channel if anyone's interested.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for talking. Thanks so much for talking to us and sharing your music.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And I'm sorry about all the delays and the hiccups, but thank you for being patient.
Oh, we enjoyed it very much. I think it turned out really well.
Good. Thank you so much.
Okay. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Bye.